In our study of the Gospel of John, we're in chapter 10. And this is a discourse by the Lord Jesus Christ about 3 months before his crucifixion. You'll remember that this portion, beginning with chapter 7, was during the Feast of the Tabernacles. See, in chapter 7, verse 2, now the Jews' Feast of the Tabernacles was at hand. And then he gave these various discourses that we find, chapter 7, 8, 9, and so forth. And the Feast of the Tabernacles was in the fall of the year. And then, notice in chapter 10, verse 22, and it was at Jerusalem, the feast of the dedication, and it was winter. So this had to be some 3 months after the messages that we've read about before, and about 3 months before his crucifixion was the feast that commemorated. It was not one of the feasts of Jehovah. That is one of the feasts that had been instituted by the Lord. By the Lord Jehovah, as had the Feast of the Tabernacles. But this was a feast of dedication that had been instigated to celebrate the dedication of the rebuilt temple when the children of Israel came back from captivity. So he's speaking there at Jerusalem, and he says in John chapter 10, "Verily, verily, I say unto you, he that entereth not by the door into the sheepfold, but climbeth up some other way, the same as a thief and a robber. But he that entereth in by the door is the shepherd of the sheep. To him the porter opens, and the sheep hear his voice, and he calls his own sheep by name, and leads them, and when he puts forth his own sheep, he goes before them. And the sheep follow him, for they know his voice. And a stranger will they not follow, but will flee from him, for they know not the voice of strangers. This parable spoke Jesus unto them, but they understood not what things they were which he spoke unto them. Then said Jesus unto them again, Verily, verily, I say unto you, I am the door of the sheep. All that ever came before me are thieves and robbers, but the sheep did not hear them. I am the door. By me, if any man enter in, he shall be saved, and shall go in and out and find pasture. The thief comes not but to steal and to kill and to destroy. I am come that they might have life, and that they might have it more abundantly. I am the good shepherd. The good shepherd gives his life for the sheep. But he that is a hireling and not the shepherd, whose own the sheep are not, sees wolves coming and leaves the sheep and flees, and the wolf catches them and scatters the sheep. The hireling flees because he is a hireling and cares not for the sheep. I am the good shepherd, and know my sheep, and am known of mine. As the Father knows me, even so know I the Father, and I lay down my life for the sheep. The other sheep I have that are not of this fold, them also I must bring, and they shall hear my voice, and there shall be one fold and one shepherd." Now we have in this story, we have a shepherd, we have a door, and we have a more than one fold, and we have a porter at the door. We have sheep that belong to more than one fold, one shepherd, but more than one fold. One day there'll be one fold. Well, this passage, of course, Christ is speaking to an immediate audience, all of which are Jews. But he lets us know, because he includes us in his dissertation, because we are of these, where it says in verse 16, "And other sheep I have that are not of this fold, them also I must bring." You see, his entire audience at the time were Jewish people, and he has sheep among them. But he has other folds, or other groups, or other places for sheep. And we're that other fold, or one of those other folds here. Now then, who is the door and who is the shepherd? Well, it's rather strange, but the speaker says, "I am the door," and the speaker says, "I am the shepherd." He says, "I am both of those." And of course, These are two of seven aspects by which the Lord Jesus Christ describes his person and his ministry. And you'll notice he always repeats that, that he says he is. In chapter 6, he says, I am the bread of life. And then he repeated it. Notice back in chapter 6, verse 35, and Jesus said unto them, I am the bread of life. And then again in verse 48, I am the bread of life. And then in chapter 8, he says in verse 12, then spoke Jesus again unto them, saying, I am the light of the world. And again in verse 9, in chapter 9, verse 5, as long as I am the world, I am the light of the world. And in our chapter 10, verse 7, the last phrase, I am the door of the sheep. Verse 9, I am the door. Verse 11, I am the good shepherd. And verse 14 again, I am the good shepherd. So these peculiar designations or particular designations that Christ gives to himself, he in each occasion has repeated phrase. This is one of the peculiarities or distinguishing features of this that we speak of as the seven I Ams of Christ. And we've talked about before this word I Am. It's a very peculiar construction in the original language and really says I am. It's really a double assertion that he is. And we find that this is one of the names of the Lord Jesus Christ. Well, particularly, we want to speak of him as he says, I am the door, keeping in mind, of course, also that he says, I am the shepherd. But we want to speak of him primarily tonight as the door or the doorway, because he speaks of entering in. I am the doorway by which someone enters in. Now, we also have a porter. And who is the porter? Well, at first glance, we would say Christ is also the porter, because other scriptures, he says, I am he that openeth and no man shutteth, and he that shutteth and no man openeth. It is true that Jesus Christ is a door opener and a door shutter. But that is executively. Operatively, the door opener and the door shutter is the Holy Spirit of God. For instance, Paul's in 1 Corinthians chapter 16, he says, a great and an effectual door is opened unto me. Well, in another place in Acts, remember, Acts 16, the door was closed. He wanted to minister in a certain place, and the door was closed. But he says, the Spirit of God forbade me to preach here. And then the door was opened for his ministry in Europe. The door was closed. Well, now, Jesus Christ is the head of the church. He directs which doors shall be open and which doors shall be closed. But the actual operation of opening and closing the door is the office and ministry of the Holy Spirit. Now, you think in terms of how you and I got saved. We came through the door into the sheepfold, and we came through Jesus Christ. But the one who opened our heart's door, you might say, the one who actually gave us access into the fold operationally was the Holy Spirit of God. And so the porter is the Holy Spirit. You see, the porter wouldn't let anybody or anything inside the fold except at the behest of the shepherd. The shepherd is in command. The shepherd makes the decisions as to whether or not the doors are opened or closed. But the Holy Spirit of God opens and closes operatively. Now, we want to search this out somewhat, this matter of opening and closing the door. There are more than one door. Fact is, the study of the subject of the door is very interesting. as far as you and I are concerned, the Holy Spirit of God opens up for us three doorways in this life. He opens the door into salvation, and then he opens the door into service, and then he opens the door into worship. There is no effectual worship except by the Holy Spirit of God. This is that to which Jesus Christ was referring in John chapter 4, when he said to the woman at the well, God is spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth, for the Father seeketh such to worship him. You have never worshiped God except at the bidding of the Holy Spirit. And you have never worshiped God except as the Holy Spirit was pleased to operate in your life. That's why the Apostle Paul says in Romans chapter 8, we know not how to pray as we ought, but the Spirit himself helpeth our infirmities. You see, he prays through us. Actually, true prayer is the Holy Spirit, God the third person, speaking to God the second person and God the first person with your facility. That's what true spiritual prayer is. It's the Holy Spirit of God using your mind and your facility to carry on a conversation. And of course, you receive the benefit of it. You receive the edification. Much edification comes through prayer. You know, there are some groups that everybody prays at the same time. I have a brother and sister-in-law of such a group, and when they come to see us, they think it's so strange that we pray in a circle, one at the time, in turns. Whereas in their church, if they have a time of prayer, everybody, you know, starts praying all at one time. Their reaction is, don't you think God can hear you? You have to everybody take his turn or God won't hear you? Well, you see, that's a misunderstanding of God's full purpose in prayer. One of the major purposes in prayer is the instruction of those that hear the prayer. Right soon after I was saved, someone got me. I was in what would be called, I suppose, a liberal church, and whatever passed for prayer in that church probably was somewhat short of what God would call prayer. But anyway, I became involved in a CBMC prayer breakfast. I was saved through the ministry of the CBMC. That's the Christian Businessmen's Committee. And they had a Wednesday morning prayer meeting, still do. But only it's on Thursday now. The Wednesday morning prayer meeting is on Thursday mornings now. But then we used to pray on Wednesday morning, 6:30. And I would listen to these men pray. And I suppose I learned as much about God and his purposes how he operated through the prayers of those individuals. I learned as much or more as I ever did from sermons or commentaries. Because, you see, in true prayer, the Holy Spirit of God is speaking. And if we always pray all at the same time, if we either pray always by ourselves, never in public, and if we pray always, if we're in public, we pray all together, then how can we be instructed by the Spirit through that method? And it is a method that he uses to instruct us. I know firsthand, for I've been instructed in that way. So the Holy Spirit of God operatively opens the door to salvation, the door to service, and the door to worship. And this is at the behest of the head of the church. You see, the head, it's the job of the head to direct. And this is why when Jesus was telling the disciples in John chapters 14, 15, and 16 about the ministry of the Holy Spirit, the one that he would send, he said that he shall not speak of himself, but whatsoever he shall hear, he shall speak. And he explained this. He says, the Father has given everything over to me. So the God, the second person, Jesus Christ, executively runs the church. But the Holy Spirit of God operatively runs the church. He's here on the scene. And if you don't see this, or you don't understand this distinction, then it would be a profitable subject to be pursued. So, the Holy Spirit is the porter, even though Jesus is the door opener. You see that? It's only at the behest of Christ that doors are opened. It's only when He wants the doors opened. But they can only be opened operationally by the Holy Spirit of God. Now, Jesus Christ as this threefold doorway is portrayed in the tabernacle in the wilderness. You know, everything about the tabernacle pictures Christ. The tabernacle itself pictures Christ in some aspect. The Ark of the Covenant pictures Christ. That which is in the Ark pictures Christ. All of the items of furniture, the lampstand, the table of showbread, the table and the bread on the table, the lampstand and the light that emanates from the lampstand, the entire structure and each individual part of the structure depicts Christ in some aspect. And that's why it's a profitable subject for study, the tabernacle in the wilderness. It looks forward to Christ. Well, there were three doorways in that tabernacle. Let's describe it. Now, it has only been a few weeks since I talked about this. I understand that, but still, we'll do it again because it fits this subject matter. We've said this before. This room, in a rather remarkable way, pictures the structure itself. The structure was 30 cubits long and 10 cubits wide and 10 cubits high. And a cubit would be a foot and a half, so we can say it was 45 feet long and 15 feet wide and 15 feet high. Now, this room is not that large, but it's a good picture. You see, back where those folks are sitting in the back would be the holy place, the holiest place, where the Ark of the Covenant was and the Shekinah glory. And then there was a doorway between the two rooms, like here. Actually, it was a curtain, but it was a means of access, is what I mean. And then there was a doorway into the holy place. See, and then outside of that was the court. So the court was 100 cubits long and 50 cubits wide, or about 150 feet, 50 yards in length. Or, you know, for us, I suppose, athletically inclined, the length of it was the distance from the 50-yard line to the goal line. If you want to get a perspective of it, next time you're at a football field, you look how far it is from the 50-yard line to the goal line. And that's how far, that's the length of this court in which the building was. And it was half as wide as it was long. And inside of that court was the building. You see, the building was 45 feet long. The court was 50 yards long. So then the building was somewhat less than one-third the length of the court. Okay? You get kind of get a perspective? And so we'll say these two rooms together represent the building. And then the yard here, we'll say, represents the court. Well, you had to have access into the court, and then you had to have access into the building, and then you had to have access into the inner room of the building, called the holiest place. And Let's read about the outer court. It's in Exodus. Let's look about chapter 26 or 27. I'll find it, and then we'll go from there. The reason we're going to spend some time in this is because it pictures in a beautiful way this threefold aspect of Jesus Christ, the doorway. In Exodus chapter 27, verse 9, "And thou shalt make the court of the tabernacle for the south side southward. There shall be hangings for the court of fine twined linen of 100 cubits long for one side, and the 20 pillars thereof, and their 20 sockets shall be of brass or bronze, and the hooks and pillars of their fillets," that is bands, "shall be of silver. And likewise for the north side and the length there shall be hangings of 100 cubits long, and its pillars and its 20 sockets of bronze, and hooks and pillars and their bands of silver. And for the breadth of the court on the west side there shall be hangings of 50 cubits, their pillars 10 and their sockets 10. And the breadth of the court on the east side eastward shall be 50 cubits, and the hangings of one side of the gate shall be 15 cubits, their pillars 3 and their sockets 3. And on the other side shall be hangings 15 cubits, their pillars 3 and their sockets 3. And for the gate of the court shall be a hanging of 20 cubits, of blue and purple and scarlet and fine twined linen." Now the linen is white. "Wrought with the needlework, and their pillars shall be 4 and their sockets 4. And the pillars round about the court shall be banded with silver, and their hooks shall be of silver, and their sockets of bronze, and the length of the court shall be 100 cubits, and the breadth 50 everywhere, and the height 5 cubits of fine twined linen, and their sockets of bronze." Now, here's the picture. You have a curtain made of white linen that is about 7.5 feet high. That would be almost as high as this ceiling. If you were on the outside, unless you were 8 or 9 feet tall, you wouldn't be able to see into the court because the curtain went all the way around the court. And you couldn't get through the curtain because it was secured. It was on these pillars. Now, each pillar was set in bronze. And each one of these bronze foundations weighed about 200 pounds. They had to be carried on ox carts. And then there was a wooden post that set down in to this bronze foundation, and on top it was capped with silver. This post, which would be about 8 feet high or so, was capped with silver, and it had a little silver hook on it, and the curtain was on this silver hook and then fastened at the top and the bottom, so you couldn't get through the court. This whole structure and the court inside was surrounded by this white linen curtain that was fastened every few yards to one of these pillars set in the socket of bronze. Now, all of these materials mean something figuratively. Bronze, or anything made of copper, probably the word here is copper, speaks of divine judgment in manifestation. Silver speaks of God's mercy in manifestation. Not just his mercy, but his mercy shown or manifested, and his judgment shown or manifested. Gold stands for God's glory manifested. Now, it'll always fit wherever you see bronze, and you'll see it many, many times. Sometimes it's translated copper, sometimes bronze, and sometimes brass. Now, they tell us, I don't know this, but they tell us that there was no such thing as what we call brass at that time, that instead it was bronze. I think bronze is iron and copper and brass, tin and copper or something. I mean, don't take that now as right down the line. But both bronze and brass are alloys of copper, and it's the copper, and it, that is that is figurative. And so many times, you know, it'll say Christ had feet of polished brass and so forth. So anywhere you see it in the Bible, if it's a bronze altar, it speaks of judgment. If it's made of gold, it speaks of the glory of God being shown forth. Silver, the mercy of God shown forth. You say, how do you know that? Well, you fit it. Anywhere in the Bible you see it, and it'll always fit. That's how you know it. It must mean something. It has to mean something figuratively when we say somebody has feet of brass. You see, it has to mean something. So it does. And it'll always fit. Now, what we have here, if you were to want to go in the side of that court, you're on the outside. As an unsaved person, you are on the outside of the court. You're in the world outside of the court. Inside of the court is where God's presence is. For back in that holiest place, God's presence is manifested by what was called the Shekinah glory. And everything was gold inside of that innermost room. Now, out from or on top of the structure, you could see this great pillar of cloud or pillar of fire, which stands for the way God manifests himself to the world. The world could know that, according to Romans chapter 2, every creature of God knows that there's a God. He can know that because he's manifested outside of the place of his presence. His handiwork is manifested, the psalmist says in Psalm 19. So you could know that God was in this tabernacle, but you couldn't see the building, you see, because you're on the outside and there's this wall around it. And so if you were wanting to get acquainted with God, you'd be stopped, because you couldn't get through the wall. Now, the white linen of that wall stands for God's requirement of absolute righteousness. You remember when Jesus was speaking in the Sermon on the Mount, he said, be perfect as the Father in heaven is perfect. That's God's requirement. You cannot approach God except in perfection. Nobody but perfect people can approach unto God. And that's what this white curtain stands for. It's perfect. It stands for God's perfect requirement of righteousness. And the reason we wouldn't be able to see God. That's why the apostle says, all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. That is, because we've sinned, we cannot behold God's excellence in manifestation. We can't behold his glory. We've come short of that. And that's what this fence says. You can't come in. You're on the outside. You cannot come in because you don't measure up to God's requirement. His requirement is perfect righteousness. Now, let's suppose, being an earthling, you walk up to that wall and you look down and you'll see that picture of God's holiness is set in a foundation of bronze. That means you'll be judged by God. His judgment will be manifest, and you'll be judged for the discrepancy between what God's requirement is and what you are. And we should see ourselves as lost sinners that will be judged. But you see, if we will lift our eyes upward, we'll see that on the top of that wooden post is a silver cap. And that means that the God of judgment is also a God of mercy. And it does not only mean that. The silver also means that he has manifested his mercy. Because silver is deity, the mercy of deity in manifestation. Just as the copper tells you that his judgment will be manifested, also his mercy is manifested. And so if you look up, you have hope. If you look down, you have despair. But you must view God in both of those aspects, or all three of those aspects. Aspects number one, he requires perfect righteousness. Aspect number two, he will judge you for the discrepancy between what you are and perfection. Number three, he has displayed his mercy. Now, then what that should cause us to do is to want to find the place of his mercy. Since the wall, the post that the wall's on tells us that he's a God of mercy. Now, the post that is between that those two, the post that separates judgment from mercy, is a wooden post. And wood in the Bible stands for humanity. So, you see, God manifested both his judgment and his mercy in human form. And that's a picture of Christ. He took our judgment on the cross because he wanted to show God's mercy towards us. So, we see God's requirement. This is why it's all right for God to require perfection. It's all right for God to have a white wall. Because in human form, he has displayed his mercy at the same time he took judgment upon sinful humanity. Now, all we need to do is to be instructed as to where is the place of this mercy which has been manifested. Well, if you were to approach that court from the outside and you were to approach it on the north side, you'd see nothing but a white wall. Bronze at the bottom, silver at the top, and a white wall. If you were to approach it from the west, you'd see the same thing. If you were to approach it from the south, you'd see the same thing. You need for someone to show you the eastern gate. Because on the east, there's a door. There's a door. And the door that lets you in is a broad door, but there's only one. It's a room enough for everybody. And it's not white. Because just a white door wouldn't suffice. It's also blue. And it's scarlet, and it's purple. And all of these are woven together. And this is a picture of Jesus Christ, our Savior, who opens the door for us, and who is the doorway. Now, a door must be more than white. It must be white, but it must be more than that. It must be interwoven with something more than just the white restriction. This is God's requirement. You need blue woven into that white. And the blue speaks of the heavenly origin of our Savior. He needed to come from heaven. Now, the reason he needed to come from heaven is that's the only place from which life comes. This is a death world, not a life world. And if anything that comes from this world ends in death, we need a Savior who came from above. We need blue in the doorway. And this is what that blue in that doorway that we read about depicts. It's the heavenly origin of our Savior. And then, what's the next color? Purple. Purple stands for royalty. It's the picture of a king. You see, this world, this death world, has a king. In one sense, death is the king, is king on earth. The personage that uses death to rule is Satan. Now, this is explained to you in Hebrews chapter 2. This is the power by which Satan rules, is death. And Jesus said when he was on earth, "How shall you spoil a strong man's house unless a stronger than the strong man first bind him?" Now, this world has a ruler. And you got to have somebody that's stronger than that ruler to be your Savior, or he wouldn't be effective. There'd be no way for him to overpower. But you see, our Savior is that stronger than the strong one who binds the strong one. He's a king. He must be a king. This is why he came as a king. He manifested himself and showed forth his kingship before he showed forth his saviorhood, before he died. He came as a king. And of course, this was depicted by the kingly gifts that he received. Gold, frankincense, and myrrh are all kingly gifts. They speak of the three aspects of the ministry of the Lord Jesus Christ. His kingship, his manifestation of God's glory, the gold, his priestly office, the frankincense, and the myrrh, speaking of his humanity and his dying for us. Anyway, The doorway needed to be purple. And then it needed to be red because we needed an acceptable sacrifice for our sins. And this speaks of Christ in his sacrifice for us. And then we needed not only a Savior to die for us, but we needed someone who, before he died, would fulfill God's perfect requirements for us. We hear much about the death of Christ, and certainly we don't want to hear any less about that, because had he not died for us, he would have not been a doorway into God's presence. But had he only died for us, he still would not have been a doorway for us, because we needed his life. He lived a perfect life before he died a death. And he lived that life for us just as surely as he died that death for us. He fulfilled God's requirement. And we are perfect in God's sight as God is pleased to impute the perfect righteousness of Christ to us. And that's what permits us to get on the other side of this white wall. So Jesus Christ is the door. And this is primarily the door that's referred to in John chapter 10, but not exclusively. For you see, we're told that through the door you go out and come in. Now, if God didn't have service for us, we wouldn't need to go out, would we? We just stay in. But we go out and in. Once we find the doorway, once we have availed ourselves of the doorway, we go out and in. And the place that pictures that service is inside of this first room. Over on this side, you have the candlestick, Jesus Christ, the light of the world. Over this side, you have the table of showbread, Jesus Christ, the bread of life, as he sustains. And this first room is the place that depicts service. If you want to read that, you find it in Hebrews. I believe it's chapter 9. Let's look just a moment there. In Hebrews chapter 9. Hebrews chapter 9, then verily the first covenant had also ordinances of divine service. In a worldly, that means of this earth, an earthly sanctuary, that's talking about this same tabernacle in the wilderness. For there was a tabernacle made, the first, or the first room, in which was a candlestick and the table and the showbread, which is called the sanctuary, the holy place. In this first place, you had those two items of furniture. And after the second veil, that's that one there, the tabernacle, which is called the holiest of all, which had the golden censer. Now, actually, it was right at the doorway, but it was your means of access. And the Ark of the Covenant, over round about with gold, in which was the golden pot that had manna, and Aaron's rod that budded, and the table of the covenant. And over it, the cherubim of glory, shadowing the mercy seat, of which we cannot now speak particularly. Now, when these things were thus ordained, the priests, watch this, the priest went always into the first tabernacle, accomplishing the service of God. The first room here is the place of service, the second room, the place of worship. And this is the doorway that is opened by the porter into the place of service. And when you read the Apostle Paul saying, a door is opened unto me, he's talking about this doorway, not the one that led him into the court. But this doorway is made of exactly the same material. Let's see if we can find that back in Exodus again. I realize we're going rather rapidly in this, and maybe you're not quite getting it. That'll just induce you to want to study more. You see, in chapter 26, verse 31, and thou shalt make a veil of blue and purple and scarlet and fine twine linen of cunning work with cherubim shall it be made. Now, that's that door there in between the two places. Then look at verse 36, and thou shalt make an hanging for the door of the tent of blue and purple and scarlet and fine twine linen wrought with needlework. Thou shalt make hangings of five pillars and so forth. Now, we read about the door of the court is in chapter 27, beginning with verse 16. But you notice there are three doorways, and they all have the same construction. You need the same thing. You needed the Jesus Christ to have a place of service for you, as well as you needed him out there at the door of the court. And you also need him if you're going to have communion with God. So you see, you have these three doorways that picture Jesus Christ, our door, in three aspects in the tabernacle. Well, we want to pursue. That's very profitable and very interesting to pursue that further. But what we'd like to do now is think about Jesus Christ, the door, as he opens doors executively through the ministry of the Holy Spirit. Look at Revelation chapter 3. In Revelation 3, verse 7, and to the angel of the church in Philadelphia write, these things saith he that is holy, he that is true, he that hath the key of David, he that opens, and no man shuts, and shuts, and no man opens. This is talking about the door of service. See, I know thy works. Behold, I have set before thee an open door, and no man can shut it. For thou hast a little strength, and hast kept my word, and hast not denied my name. Behold, I will make them of the synagogue of Satan, who say they are Jews and are not, but lie. Behold, I will make them to come and worship before thy feet, to know that I have loved thee, because thou hast kept the word of my patience. I will also keep thee from the hour of temptations which shall come upon the world to try them that dwell upon the earth. Behold, I come quickly. Hold that fast which thou hast, that no man take thy crown. You see, this is speaking of doing his work on earth, for which we receive a crown. Crowns speak of rewards for service, not of salvation. And so he's the door opener. And when he opens a door of service, no man can shut it. He opens it. Now let's look at some of these instances where he opens and where he shuts. Remember, Jesus is the door opener executively. The Holy Spirit is the door opener operationally. 1 Corinthians chapter 16. Verse 8, Paul says, but I will tarry at Ephesus until Pentecost, for a great door and effectual is opened unto me. He's speaking about a doorway of service. Then in 2 Corinthians chapter 2, verse 12. Furthermore, when I came to Troas to preach Christ's gospel, and a door was opened to me of the Lord. This is speaking when he first came into, first brought the ministry into Europe in answer to the Macedonian call. The Holy Spirit shut the door. He said the Holy Spirit forbade him to go where he wanted to go. But another door was opened for him. This is the door to service. Colossians chapter 4. The book of Colossians chapter 4. Verse 3. Continue in prayer. Verse 2. Continue in prayer and watch in the same with thanksgiving. Praying also for us that God would open unto us a door of utterance to speak the mystery of Christ, for which I am in bonds. We won't look at it just now, but you remember the scene, it's twice in the Gospel of John, once in the 19th chapter and once in the 20th chapter, when Christ rose from the dead. It says that the disciples were in a room, the doors being locked, but the locked door had no was no bar to the risen Christ, was it? The door being closed, he appeared before them, because there is no way to shut the door opener out. He can't be shut out. Now, there's another aspect of Jesus Christ, the door opener. One day he's going to open a door for us. And the Apostle John saw a foreview of such a door in Revelation chapter 4. Revelation 4, 1. The Apostle says, after this I looked, and behold, a door was opened in heaven. Now, this is a foreview of that time. The door is going to be opened for you to enter in at the rapture of the church. One day, our Lord is going to say, well, this old world has putrefied to the extent that I don't want mine there anymore. Their righteous spirits have been grieved for long enough by the filth and sin of this world. And he's going to open a door into heaven and take us to himself. And this is a picture of that door, that will be opened. It's real interesting, because if you want to be one of those to enter in that open door, there needs to be another door opened, and that's in Revelation chapter 3. Verse 20, behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door, I will come into him. It's true that the Holy Spirit of God operationally is the door opener. But the way we open the door is being willing to have the door opened to us, whether it's to salvation or to service. No doubt the Revelation 3:20 scripture is speaking primarily of service. But start with me if you want to apply it to salvation. Now, in Revelation chapter 19, there's going to be another door opening. Revelation 19:11. And I saw heaven opened, and behold, a white horse. And he that sat upon him was called Faithful and True, and in righteousness he doth judge and make war. His eyes were like a flame of fire. You see, in chapter 4, the door was opened to let us in, because this old world is going to go through a terrible time. Then in chapter 19, it's already been through that time, and we're coming back with him to reign. So he opens the door to let us back out of glory. And notice our condition then. Chapter 19, verse 7, let us be glad and rejoice and give honor to him, for the marriage of the Lamb is come, and his wife hath made herself ready, and to her was granted that she should be arrayed in fine linen, clean and white. For the fine linen is the righteousness, righteousnesses, or the righteous acts of the saints. You see, we'll have that requirement. Be ye perfect as the Father in heaven is perfect. We will be perfect because we will have an imputed righteousness which is perfect and which looks to the time when he will wash us white, and we will be as white as God requires, which is completely. And that's what Isaiah was saying. He said, come, let us reason together. Though your sins be red like crimson, they shall be white like wool. Though they be scarlet. Anybody know that verse better than I do? It's Isaiah 1:18. Anybody want to recite Isaiah 1:18 for us?
Though they be scarlet, they shall be white as snow. Though they be crimson, they shall be red as wool.
Okay. Well, somebody didn't want to cite it. We've had it almost letter perfect here. Somebody want to read it? Isaiah 1:18. That's what we're going to end on. Isaiah 1:18. Lauren is going to read it in perfect English.
Reason together, saith the Lord. Though your sins be as scarlet, they shall be as white as snow. Though they be red like crimson, they shall be as wool.
Yeah, and there we see that. Just what Isaiah was speaking of, we see it in Revelation chapter 19. As white as wool. So we have something to look forward to, do we not? Let's pray. Lord, we thank you that the door is not closed for us, that we have a porter standing by who opened the door unto salvation, and who is glad to open the door into service and open the door into worship. We thank you for this kind provision in Jesus' name. Amen.